All right. Good morning, everybody. Great to be here. So we'll get right into it. I can see questions are brewing. So I'm going to try to introduce to you some of the interesting security challenges in the medical space, but particularly to medical devices. These are devices that treat patients, diagnose patients. They are some of the most extreme devices I've seen. And I'd like to draw a little parallel. I'm a history buff and a classicist at heart, but I'm not going to go back to BC, but I'd like to draw some parallels to the 1800s. There's a very interesting piece of medical research that happened around in the 1840s by a number of physicians, including one Ignaz Semmelweis. He discovered that his students who were working in the morgue in the morning and then later went to go work with patients, well, those patients tended to have a higher mortality rate for some reason. And so he did a control study, and he discovered, you know what, if you wash your hands after doing that, your patients tended to live. So the reaction from the physician community was, well, doctors are gentlemen, and therefore their hands are always clean. Sort of complete denial, even in the face of the statistics. And so there were actually some real reasons for that denial. And even today, we have trouble with hand washing and sterile technique. Infection is still a leading hazard in our clinical facilities, and I'll try to explain why using this example. I usually pass around my one of my defibrillators from my defibrillator collection. This is a defibrillator. I'm not going to do that today just because there's too many people. I have a picture of a pacemaker, which is very similar to a defibrillator. It allows you to have a faster heart rate. This is an electrode that is woven through a sacrificed blood vessel. This one hasn't yet been used. It is used for both sensing cardiac arrhythmia as well as delivering life-saving shocks. So this is a picture from my colleagues at Medtronic of one of their early devices before they had wireless control of the implant. And there's actually a very good reason to have wireless control, but this was one without wireless. So if you take a look at that little metal wire coming out the right-hand side, you might wonder what that is. That's technically what you would use to program the device. So in the days before wireless control, the physician would ask the patient, please lift up your arm, plunge a needle through the armpit to twist a dial to change your heart rate. So as you can imagine, this had the ick factor, but it also had the problem of infection control. Infection was a real risk. It's not something you think about unless you're in one of those university laboratories typing on keyboards. But infection is a real issue. And so that is why you see wireless communication entering medical devices. It's there for a real good reason, to reduce the risk of infection. The story you won't hear too much, but if you talk with some of the engineers who worked on these devices, some of the things that used to happen back in the days of the old dial, well, you might have an elderly couple with some late night activities, and they need to elevate their heart rate for something, so they just find any object they could and try to get their heart rate up. And so for these kinds of reasons, you would get infections. So today, these implants are largely wirelessly controlled, not in the sense of your consumer 802.11 wireless, but typically some kind of proprietary wireless system. And I'll just give you an example. I'm not going to talk too much about research, but here's some research I participated in about 8 years ago where we were able to induce ventricular fibrillation wirelessly using a defibrillator. So there's this little wand that's used to program the device, and the device is implanted. Only takes about 90 minutes. It's a relatively routine procedure. The patient is awake, slightly sedated with a local anesthetic. After the device is implanted, it's sewn up, it's tested, the patient goes home, and typically they have some kind of what looks like a base station, sits at your bedside. It collects what's called your telemetry from your implanted device, sends it up to the clinicians so the clinicians can look over an HTTPS website how you're doing in case you need to be brought in early, in case something unexpected is going on. These devices save lives. Don't get me wrong, these devices are very important. However, and this was a device that's no longer manufactured, but what we found a number of years ago, I handed to a team of students and colleagues a defibrillator and oscilloscope. And by eavesdropping on the radio communication between an implant and a programmer, they were basically able to pull out the entire electronic health record, unable to find any kind of evidence of encryption going on. They also did what was called a replay attack, where they recorded certain commands to disable all the wireless therapies, and they also replayed a command to induce a fatal heart rhythm. It turns out built into many devices is a debugging command, for good reason, to induce a fatal heart rhythm. And the reason for that is, how do you test if a defibrillator is working properly in a patient if they have a normal heart rhythm? So built into the device is a little command to induce a fatal heart rhythm such that you can see if the device recognizes it and brings them back. Luckily, these devices are no longer manufactured, at least the ones we looked at, but there's still a long way to go. I do want to emphasize, though, that patients are just far better off with these devices than without. I'm not going to be saying that the sky is falling or that we should be running for the hills. If I were prescribed one of these devices today, I would take it in a heartbeat, literally. Security, in my view, is still, even though I'm a security researcher, I consider it sort of a secondary fact after safety. So where are we in terms of security in medical devices? There's so many examples I could point to, so I'll just point to one of the more recent ones. Billy Rios is a very talented security researcher, former Marine, or technically, you're never a former Marine, you're always a Marine. He took a look at one infusion pump. And it took over a year for the manufacturer to get back to him, but he found some very interesting problems. Is anyone in the audience sort of like a red teamer or does any kind of security investigation, forensics? Okay. So I'd be curious to get your take. So there is it wasn't a recall, but FDA very rarely issues a recall, but they issued what's called a product advisory, basically saying stop buying these devices. Try to find something else to infuse drugs into your patients. And the reason why is Billy found that, well, if you tell not to port 23, you get a root shell. Okay, so we don't know if there's any technology sold on the market that can solve this. Or there are these hard-coded local accounts. And by the way, if you do use the wireless network, the keys are stored unencrypted, accessible via Telnet and FTP. By the way, those are the passwords down at the right. So most of the time what we find in medical devices is not anything advanced. It's more like breaking down an open door. And some manufacturers are better than others at responding. I'll tell you more about infusion pumps a little later in the talk. But most of it boils down to poor hygiene or just not understanding some of the ramifications of security choices made in early design. If you want to find malware, go to a hospital. It's a very unique environment. A colleague of mine once gave me a picture of his network architecture, the architecture is not too interesting, not too unique, but what is interesting is the breakdown of operating systems. If you squint and look carefully, you can see that they have 664 sort of traditional operating systems on their medical devices. These are things like MRIs, radiology machines, all sorts of different kinds of devices, typically with a monitor. And you'll notice there's a little line there of 600 Windows XP machines in this hospital. And by the way, that's 600 version Surface Pack 0 XP machines, not a patch ever since the birth of Windows XP, because they had difficulty getting patches from the manufacturer. So what you'll find in hospitals is a whole bunch of legacy equipment. By the way, the Windows 95 is what they call the magnet. That's the MRI. If they want to upgrade to a newer operating system, I'm told they have to buy a new magnet, which costs several million dollars. So this is why you're going to see a lot of old operating systems. These capital costs are very difficult to just suddenly throw away. By the way, it takes about 12 days to get infected when they have no kind of mitigating controls in place. Although when they have some kind of mitigating control, like antivirus or firewalls, it tends to get them up to nearly a year before the device gets infected. So what about on the manufacturing side? There's some interesting stories that I've begun to collect on security problems at factory installation. The picture on up here is one of a ventilator for breathing. It's a very common device in a facility. If you need it, I highly recommend you use it. Don't deny it. But I noticed that there was an FDA recall on this device, and so, you know, like any good security researcher, I just like to download executables on the internet and run them and see what happens. So I found their website. I clicked on the little link that said download your ventilator firmware update. I thought, so cool. I clicked on it, and I think I know the guy in the room who can answer what this is. This little dialog box popped up from Chrome. It said, warning, visiting the site may harm your computer. This website you are visiting appears to contain malware, right? So many of you know what this is. Those of you who don't, go ask one of the people who do. But basically, this poor manufacturer got attacked, and they were distributing a little malware bonus package along with their medical device firmware update. So good old Niels over at Google, of course, was very involved with the safe web browsing service. And so you can go and investigate why Google thinks that this particular manufacturer was distributing malware. And according to Google, there were 19 pages resulting in this malicious software with 38 Trojans and 3 scripting exploits, a bonus package. Now, what's interesting to me is that the type of person who downloads this update is not me. The type of person who downloads a ventilator firmware update is a biomedical engineer or a clinical engineer. These are not security experts, nor should they be. And what I want to know is, did they click continue or ignore? You know, so chances are they needed to get their job done, they needed to get that firmware out there, and they probably have infected their local computer as a result. There are plenty of other ways that malware gets into the supply chain of the healthcare industry. An interesting one was at the VA, where there was a contractor who was doing software updates and software maintenance and accidentally brought in malware with a USB stick as the vendor himself was doing updates of the medical devices. There was another case of a vendor of what's called a compounder. If you're from New England, you might have heard of the meningitis outbreak with the New England Compounding Company. But compounders make custom drugs for IV delivery. And one happens to run Windows XP. And it got infected with a virus. And the more interesting part, at least according to an engineer that used to work there, was he told me, well, that was only half the story. Yeah, the device got infected, but then when the device was under repair, it was accidentally spread to the other compounders under repair. So it's sort of a Typhoid Mary of the medical device security world. Just to give you an idea of just sort of this is low-hanging fruit. This is not some sinister hacker necessarily, but let me just give you a snapshot of the last 5 days of medical device security. So a week ago, FDA issued some new regulatory guidance on what they expect for responsible disclosure, coordinated disclosure rather, for medical device security and looking for these problems. But let me tell you what happened within the 4 days after that. A hospital in Australia was attacked. A virus got into their Windows XP computers in their pathology department, and now they are doing manual processing of specimens of blood, tissue, and urine samples because their computer systems are still down. That was on Monday. Tuesday, apparently nothing happened. But on Wednesday, all those happy days, a hospital in Texas experienced the wonderful crypto locker virus, and they're now struggling with getting their systems back online. That was on Wednesday. On Thursday, the same manufacturer of the pump I just showed you had a new product advisory. The CERT ICS announced that there was a buffer overflow vulnerability that is remotely accessible by port 5000. And they said the difficulty of this was low skill. In other words, breaking down an open door. And then don't forget Friday. On Friday in my home state of Michigan, a hospital in Flint confirmed that there was a cyber attack on their medical systems. They haven't given much more details, but there were hacktivists protesting some of the lead water problems we're having up in Flint. So there's 1 week in the world of medical device security. Okay, so if Ignaz Semmelweis were alive today, and were instead of talking about the importance of hand washing, if he were instead talking about medical devices and security, he'd probably be saying something like, medical devices should be secure, and doctors are gentlemen or gentlewomen, and therefore their computers are always secure. But they were very sexist. The interesting part is the denial is very, very similar to the denial in the 1800s. So thank goodness we have plumbing. Okay, I'll tell you, the P-trap for those plumbing was invented in the early 1840s. Before that, we had sewer gas problems all over the place. I mean, it's almost like living in San Francisco. Was that too close to home? this is a Super Bowl, right? What kind of bowl? You can imagine asking a physician to wash their hands in the 1840s when not every hospital had running water. It's very similar today. When you ask someone, just put security on it, there is no silver bullet. In fact, there's probably a lot, I would argue there's a lot more snake oil out there than stuff that actually works. Just slap a firewall on there. Yeah, that'll help reduce your risks, but it's no panacea. The malware just gets in by USB drive or social engineering over the telephone. We're going to have a long way to go. It's taken over 160 years for hand washing. I don't expect the medical device security problem to be solved in just 10 years. But what we do know, the tried and true method to get good security is security needs to be designed in from the very beginning, not bolted on. And I'm comforted to know, I work quite a bit with manufacturers now, and I'm very comforted to know that they are actually doing security engineering at the whiteboard stage before they've written a line of code, before they've written one requirement. They're already thinking about security. The problem, of course, is you have these product life cycles, and it will be some number of years before you start to see the outcomes of this good security engineering. But bolting it on after the fact is not going to be a long-term solution. I will just show you one thing. I am the chief scientist at Virta Laboratories, a startup company. But one of the interesting things we're doing, we've noticed just how difficult hospitals, hospitals have had putting security approaches onto their medical devices, because these are very difficult devices to modify. So instead, we built a power outlet. And what's interesting about this power outlet is it analyzes your power consumption patterns to determine whether or not you're infected with malware or other types of anomalies. So it's sort of like a thermometer for weird things that go on embedded computer systems to help you detect problems before you spread them. Apparently, like, the average time to detecting an infection is something like 209 days. I think it's got down to 209 days on median. We'd like to see that a little bit lower, maybe at least 200. But it's interesting to be able to catch some kinds of malware just through the power outlet in just a few seconds. So toward the future, you're going to hear in the media, you know, the most interesting thing is always the hacker side. So you're going to see a lot of media focusing on hackers breaking into medical devices. I'm not saying that's untrue. It is true that hackers do that. But if you were to ask me the question, like, what's the biggest risk? I'm actually more concerned with more basic stuff akin to hand washing. These are not things with malicious intent against medical devices, but it's about wide-scale unavailability to deliver patient care. If your cath lab gets infected by a common, just garden variety piece of malware, you can't deliver care. You can't give that angioplasty. You tell your patients to be transported to another hospital for their critical cardiac conditions. When your medical devices that are doing diagnostics get infected by malware, they start changing subtle things like interrupt patterns. You start to miss interrupts. The software is not designed to behave when malware is running on the computer. And so the integrity of those medical sensors are compromised, and you no longer can have good confidence in the diagnostics coming from those devices. I encourage people, both professionals in the industry as well as students, to look at medical device security as an area for work. It needs your help. But the important thing is, do not interrupt clinical workflow. I have seen so many armchair solutions, just slap a password on it, just do this thing we use in IT. You know, the last thing you want is a pacemaker that locks you out after three attempts of a password, I'll tell you, okay? So don't interrupt clinical workflow. Don't expect the clinician community to change for you. Whatever you do, it needs to be seamless. It needs to just fit in, so they don't need to change the way they work with patients. And the problem is, many of the best security specialists out there are more focused on what I would call technical controls. Deploy this technology, install this, configure that, disable this, don't allow that kind of behavior. Whereas what you'll find in hospitals are safety specialists who focus on what's called risk management. They accept risk because patients are already predisposed to risk. Therefore, they may actually choose not to implement a security solution because it might mean they can keep the patient safer or the workflow will be preserved. So it's not always the case that you'll deploy security. Sometimes you actually accept the risk. But trustworthy medical device software requires both of these, safety and security, and I think you'll find that there are technologies that give you both. Classic stuff like static analysis will help you with both. There are plenty of other examples. But I think I'll just end with, medical device security is in its very early stages. I've been working in it for about 10 years now. But I think you'll be seeing, we're currently in a phase of sort of the breaking down open doors, but I'm actually optimistic because what I'm seeing at some of the better manufacturers are serious, honest attempts at bringing better security engineering into these products. If you'd like to learn more, I've got a website up there with sort of a blog of all sorts of other interesting examples, but I think I'll end there to take any questions, and I hope you appreciate some of the complexities now of medical device security and why it's not as simple as just doing a software update. Thank you.